and on the streets of Vilnius. Eight people, citizens of Vilnius, were commemorated by them. It's Fania Lavando, Vasil Lavando, Leib Haye and Lili Shamanic, Samuel Margolis, Jakub Vygotsky, and Isko Rudashevsky. We, the Sanctuary, hope and expect that the stones is a symbolic gesture and towards better understanding and the most importantly, acknowledging on what was happening in 1941, 1944 on the soil in Lithuania. The Holocaust affected great many people, and most of them, well, not most of them, all of them were neighbors of our grandparents. Despite that, when I think personally about this tragedy, it feels to me that we know still very little about those who died, about those who perished in the Holocaust. We know the numbers, and maybe we know the sites of the mass graves. But when I think about the narrative of the Holocaust in Lithuania, probably, you know, 2 years ago, I knew nobody who saw this happening, or I knew nobody who was affected by the Holocaust in Lithuania. Therefore, I think that numbers, the 6 million people, it doesn't really, you know, give the real picture of what was happening in Europe and specifically in Lithuania. That a quarter of a million people have been killed here. So therefore, I'm thrilled to present the speaker of today, Professor Efraim Sikat, and later on, Yossi Shemari will join us. And I'm just going to tell that Efraim Sikat came to Lithuania to commemorate his the sister of your grandmother. Two stones for the Lavando family were installed yesterday on Vokiečių Street 14. And so now I'm going to give you the floor. Later, Yossi will join us. After that, I'm going to ask you a few questions, and the audience is more than welcome to join in and, you know, participate in the discussion. Is that right?
Can everyone see? If there's anyone who can't hear me, wave your hand like that, frantically. And if anyone doesn't understand me, wave two hands frantically. If there's anything that is not clear, just stop me or repeat it. I'll try to speak slowly for the benefit of any Americans who don't understand British English. First of all, I feel, pleasure is not the word, but a great privilege to be here in Vilna for this event organized by the Lithuanian Committee for Human Rights. I think that what they've done here, their initiative, is not just important, I think that it is of great historical significant, and I hope it's just the beginning of commemoration of the Lithuanian Jewish victims of the Holocaust on a scale that has not hitherto been seen in Lithuania. I also want to thank my wife for putting up with these long lectures and accompanying me here. And generally being a good support and trying not to forget anything to pack. And of course, thank you to Eve Yohanovich, who has been in the events up to now, and I don't know if she's going to come tonight. No one was waving frantically.
I was about to wave.
Yes, some waving frantically. Who translated the book into the cookbook that Fania Lavando published here in 1938 into English, And that small publication event set off a whole chain of very incredible consequences where all of a sudden everyone in the world has heard of Fania Lavanda. Fania Lavanda was not unknown in her own day. She was very well known here in Verona because she had a restaurant on Kirchu Gasse, which in Yiddish is called Deutsche Gasse, of Nemieska Polisa, number 14, where he named the Therms. And let's not just think about how 75 years ago, Jews were taken from their homes and massacred by the Nazis and the Lithuanian collaborators. Let's talk also about the hundreds of years during which Jews and Lithuanians lived together, worked side by side, contributed to this country and to each other's cultures. It's the, chronologically, it's a very small episode, but one that put an end to that very long history of the Jews in Lithuania. Known as the Jerusalem of Lithuania, Vilna was long famous as a center of Jewish learning and culture. It had thriving communal and cultural institutions, charity organizations, and every type of secular and religious school. Vilna was a stronghold of the Socialist Jewish Bund and the Zionist organizations Polizion, Polizion, Mizrahi, and many others. They say that if you have 10 Jews in the room, you have 20 political parties and 50 opinions. Between the two world wars, when Vilnius was part of Poland, the town witnessed the heyday of Yiddish theatre, and with the emergence of the Jugendliche Vilna movement, modernist poetry. It was home to YIVO, the Institute for Yiddish Studies, that is now in New York, and which sponsored the publication of the English translation of Fania Lavanda's cookbook. 85% of Vilna's 35,000 Jews declared Yiddish as their first language. Despite Vilna's economic and cultural marginalization during the interwar years, it was one of the major centers of Jewish culture in Eastern Europe before the Holocaust. Fania Lavanda's Yaska Yavodania, the restaurant, a vegetarian restaurant on Okichu Gazva, owned by Lazar Lavanda and operated by my great aunt Fania, or she was known in our family, Fega, was the center point of intellectual life in Vilna, because Vilna's leading intellectuals, or the who's who of Jewish Vilna, came to the restaurant not just to eat, but to talk about art and politics. If you look at the list of the names of guests in Fania's guestbook, at the end of the cookbook, in Yiddish as well as in English, and now in Lithuanian editions, you will recognize quite a few names, including Marc Chagall, who, rather mischievously, says he has a very delicate stomach, but the food was tasty. I can easily imagine the scintillating conversation that must have taken place at the tables and between the tables in the restaurant. But this was no ordinary restaurant, and Fania, no ordinary woman. In 1938, can we have this? family in her restaurant. Yes.
Okay. Well, I'm figured. But this was no ordinary restaurant. The family was no ordinary woman. In 1938, Fanny of the Land had published her vegetarian meat cookbook, and she was more known than Vilna and beyond. Kitchen and next one, and then I'll go back. The Yiddish press reported on a luxury cruise across the Atlantic, on which Fanny of the Band served as the guest gourmet chef, accompanied by a uniformed rabbi to supervise the kosher food preparation. And besides being a businesswoman and a proponent of vegetarian Jewish cooking, Vanya was also active in teaching local Jewish women the fine points of correct nutrition in her dietary lessons. Can we have the next one?
And here we see the next one. Yes.
And here we see her
at the Freier Verein, the Women's Institute in Vilna, which encouraged women to be independent and encouraged women's health women's care of their health issues, and also trained women who are taking up domestic employment. You see the students there on the right, and even listening to Fania, who's standing there at the end of the counter. And this is the 1930s. Nowadays we take for granted correct nutrition, healthy diet, cholesterol, weight, carbohydrates, fats, and everyone knows all about it, and if they don't, they soon get a lecture from their doctor. But in those days, in the 30s, in general, people were not so aware. And so I think what she was doing was pioneering work, especially working among women, and offering her own example as an independent businesswoman. One thing you'll notice if you read Yiddish is that the pots on the top shelf are very clearly labelled. On the left, milchik, dairy, on the right, fleishik, meat pots. So you can realise that this dietary lesson is not about necessarily vegetarianism, but it's about healthy living, and that was also one of the principles in Fanny de Vanzer's cookbook. Something about my great aunt. Fanya Vega was born in Wrocław, in northern Poland, in 1888, to Chaim Ephraim Fischlewicz, a fishmonger whose business often took him across the German border, and Esther Machler, my great-great-grandparents. She was the second of six children, out of them girls. Can we go next slide? Now that's the Cluster Cookbook, which I should have shown you before. The other way. And more. A little further. Here. That's it. Stop.
She was the second of six children, five of them girls. Her family immigrated to England in 1901. Where someone at immigration control changed the name from Fischlewicz, which apparently is not a name, to Fischer. But Fania remained in Poland, which was then still ruled by the Russian Tsar, and then she married Lazar Eliezer Levando, an egg merchant who was born in Vilna in 1880. Lazar was apparently arrested one day when, after the Russian Revolution, the Soviets invaded Poland, the Poland had invaded Ukraine, probably known, the Soviets pushed them back, and then invaded Poland with the intention of spreading the communist revolution throughout Europe. They came to this area also, and one day Lazar found himself arrested by the communists as a capitalist, because he was a bourgeois merchant. And fortunately, he was able to escape by jumping off a train, which through which he injured his leg. And that's something that I ask you to remember. He injured his leg. Suzanne Vanya lived in Vilna, which meanwhile had passed under Polish control, but it should have been the capital of independent Lithuania. If you have any Jewish relatives in your family, you'll know that no one's ever sure in which country they were born or died, because the countries kept moving. They didn't necessarily move, but the borders moved, and some people were born in Poland and found themselves one day in Ukraine and ended up in, as a third country without having gone anywhere. At some time during the 30s, the situation in Vilna was getting more difficult for the Jews. For mainly traders, the economic conditions were much harsher. Around the middle of the 30s, the Polish nationalists were very active here. The boycott of Jewish businesses and pogroms of the scenes around Poland. Things were not going well for the Jewish population. Quite a few left for the United States, or if they could get the certificate, the immigration certificate from the British to the land of Israel, which was then under British rule. The United States refused to give an immigration visa to the Levandos on account of Lazar's leg injury, which, if you remember, he got in 1920 when he ran away from the communists. After a second and last short visit to her family in England, Vanya had returned to Vilna, where life was getting very difficult. Don't forget, Jews were very active in trade and finance. Now they found it harder to make a living, and attacks on Jews increased. I think this is also something that's important to remember when we read the cookbook, that many of the recipes are intended to help the Jewish housewife cope with the increasingly difficult conditions by giving recipes that were very easy to make from readily available ingredients like mushrooms and apples, of which you have so many in the forest here. And you have a lot of forests. So when readers in New York bought the English translation, they were rather they found it rather difficult to find a forest nearby, and they couldn't understand why they had to buy a certain kind of mushroom that cost so many dollars per pound in the specialty store. We have to remember that these were ingredients that were widely and easily available. And that's something that Tanya always stresses in the cookbook. Don't waste, cook economically. Use the water from your vegetables, from your fruit. Again, never throw it away. So bear in mind that people did not have easy lives like we do, and ingredients had to be reasonably priced so that people could afford them. With Germany's invasion of Poland and the outbreak of war in September 1939, in accordance with the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact, Eastern Poland and the Baltic states, including Vilna, were ceded to the Soviet Union, while Germany took the rest of Poland. After a brief spell of independence, Lithuania was incorporated into the Soviet Union on June 5, 1940. Communist rule could not have been easy for the Jews of Vilna, who relied on free trade, though some welcomed the Soviets out of fear of Nazi Germany or because of ideological conviction. The rabbinical seminaries in Yeshivot. The synagogues were all closed down, and only a few Yiddish separate institutions were permitted to function. On June 22, 1941, the Nazis invaded the Soviet Union and entered Vilna, as you probably know, on June 24th, followed by the Einsatzgruppen killing squads on September 6th. Some, except for the Jewish ghetto in the city, as many as 70,000 Jews were murdered in the Pomeroy Forest. And although we do not have exact dates, we know from witnesses' accounts that Fanya and Lazar ran away, trying to get away desperately from the Nazis, who, as you know, were murdering Jews all over Lithuania 75 years ago this week. And I think that we can, if though we do not know for certain exactly where they ran away, how they ran away, we can in our mind easily imagine that had we been there, if there was any possibility, any real possibility of escape before the ghetto was set up, I think we would have taken that risk. Not everyone succeeded in getting away, not everyone reached the destination. Many tried to get to the Soviet lines to run eastwards, away from the advancing Germans. When the ghetto was set up, of course, in a way it's safer in the ghetto than outside the ghetto, because outside the ghetto you could be either captured or killed on the spot by the Germans or by the Lithuanian fascists. So we do not know at what point Lazar and Fanya ran away. We have witness accounts that they were captured by Soviet soldiers, and that is the last we know about them. So last we heard, the family heard from them, or letters stopped coming. I imagine that if they had survived, they would have made contact. Many Jews who were captured by the Soviet forces were sent to Siberia, sometimes to camps or exiled in Siberia, sometimes in Central Asia. Very, very difficult, very harsh conditions. But there was a chance of survival. They weren't being sent there to be killed. But since we have no knowledge at all about what happened, we can only speculate. The next. This is Fanya Lovando, the last photograph of her in Germany in 1939, just shortly before the Nazi invasion of Poland. Next slide. And this is Lazar Lovando, her husband. And this. This is the legacy of Fanya Lovando, the English translation of a book which brought her to worldwide fame. If you Google her on the internet, you'll find thousands and thousands of articles, reviews, and of course, video interviews with Eve Kanovich, the translator. And all this because of two, all this because one day two women went into the Euro rare book section and saw this very rare copy of Fanya Lovando's Yiddish cookbook and decided it had to be translated. So it's like the kind of butterfly effect. Except that we have two butterflies here. So the fact that the wings and everything in the world changed, at least regarding Fanya Lovando, and almost overnight. The book published and became bestseller, and everyone started talking about Fanya Lovando, talking about her recipes, but most important, I think, is not just the taste of the Jewish kitchen in Vilna, but the legacy that she's left us of the world that she lived in, the world that one saw every day in her restaurant, French writers, intellectuals, a world that has now been completely destroyed. So this book, and now its Lithuanian translation, are the tombstone for Fania, Lavanda, and her husband, Lazar. They have no grave, as far as we know, and they have no actual stone. So now, as a result of the publication of the cookbook, we have also now the Stockelsteiner, the stones actually on the ground by the Russian. So I very much want to thank those two women, those two butterflies, are here with us today, Wendy Waxman and Barbara Mazur, whose small efforts, well, not too small efforts, they're great efforts to have the book published, but a small step has led to a number of events that culminated yesterday in the unveiling of the Stockelsteiner. So we are commemorating today not just this tragedy of the disappearance of two Jews who were very much at the center of the Jewish life, but the world that they lived in, which has gone forever, well, not quite forever, because now we see their legacies continue to slide. And here we have the Jewish Vegetarian Society launch of the book in London with my cousins from left to right, Carol Skolnick, Shelley Sinclair, and Ian Skolnick. Next slide, also that's event. There'll be a number of events around the world. Next slide, please. And the book is an English edition, and also a Lithuanian edition, dedicated to the memory of Fanny Lavanda, a pioneering thinker and cook, and a passionate educator who devoted her life to promoting health
and vitality. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Anthony. Now I'm going to introduce you to Yossi Shemagi. His grandparents, Leif and Haya, were killed during the Holocaust. His grandmother was killed in 1928, and his grandfather was escorted to a camp in Estonia and killed. Well, actually, was he got killed there. And his aunt, who was 12 years old at that time, was burned in those donies. Yossi, along with his family, came to Vilnius to install three stones for his grandparents and for the aunt Lily. So, I'm going to give you...
Thank you, Yossi. Thank you very much. Can everyone hear me okay? Okay. I have one quick advice for everyone. Never ask to speak after a literature professor. That's just not a place that you want to be.
You were late.
I was late.
Exactly.
So it's on me, Brian. It's on me. You're very eloquent, and so
students who are late always have to sit at the back of the class.
That's right. So I'm not going to be as eloquent, but I'll try to share a couple of things, and then I'm going to have my sister and daughter and my niece join for a couple of words. I'd like to frame this around the work of my father in his memoir that I showed yesterday. It's called Behind the Gate. And this gate actually exists here in the ghetto. We saw it yesterday. We walked by there. It's a symbolic gate, but it's also a physical gate with a true story that one of the times that he remained in the ghetto with his mother after his father was taken to Estonia, never to return, and his little sister was already burned in Vazdoni. So anyways, he was behind this gate, actually hiding during one of the actions with his mother. They were called through the court, and they found their hiding places and they gathered several families together and herded them to be taken to Ponar, and he last minute pulled his mother behind the gate. It was early evening, and they hid there the whole evening until the morning, and then they found another hiding place. So that bought them a few more months of life for his mother, for my grandmother. And so so that's the story behind the gate. And a friend of mine, who is a poet in Charlotte, North Carolina, actually came up with the idea of the book Behind the Gate, because it's a true event, physical event that happened, but also it has a symbolism for our family, for perhaps the Jewish people, how sometimes we are left the other side of the gate throughout history. And but it's very, very uplifting that my father, through his life, he's 90 years old now, lives in Tel Aviv with our mother, was able to crack open that gate and really make a wonderful life for himself and our mother and ourselves. And for that, I admire him very, very much, and I love that name. From the preface of the book, I just want to read one paragraph that he wrote exactly 10 years ago when he was 80. He said, "The relative short years of the war cannot ever erase from my conscience, and they follow me like a constant, inseparable shadow. Despite the reality, the heavy load of those memories did not inhibit me from taking an active part in the fabric of life with dedication, loyalty, and joy. The past did not weaken my resolve, darken my spirit, nor impede my desire for life and renewal. It is not uncharacteristic for survivors to rehabilitate their lives, start families, and thrust themselves into full productive existence." That's certainly been a part of his life. There was one, and I'm not going to read this, I'm going to try to paraphrase. The first half of his memoir, you descend down to hell, basically, and then you start getting up slowly. Which, by the way, I later found out in life, if anyone has been to the Holocaust Museum in Washington, D.C., the architecture, I'm sure some of you have been there, some of the Americans, the architecture there is just brilliant. And that's physically, that's what they do. They take you into hell, you start at the top floor, and then you go down, and then you come back up. And that symbolically has been his life. But the bottom of the bottom was one episode, and I'm not going to read it, so bear with me. I'm trying to paraphrase. After he was alone, he was 17 years old, his parents are gone, and his sister is gone, and other relatives, grandmother, and so on. Through a friend, he found himself with the Red Army, not as a soldier, but just working, basically for food and clothing. And they were actually going towards Berlin, and he was in a mess unit, which is a I'm not sure. It's a hospital, basically, unit. And he was just doing chore work, making coffee and delivering the mail and things like that. I mean, he didn't have any training as a soldier. So, unfortunately, the war was won, and this is May 8, 1945, and the fighting stopped. So he's only training with this mesh unit, this Russian army, and they were celebrating, drinking a lot of vodka, this day of the war. And he was trying to figure out, what am I going to do? I mean, he had no idea where to go, east, west, north, or south. And certainly didn't have any money, didn't have anything except his Red Coat Army. So they told him that no one is released yet. And they told him that we would like to take you to Moscow, because you were a very important unit in the front line of the Red Army that liberated Berlin, because Stalin himself is going to decorate you with the Red Star that he was giving to all the soldiers. So there's my father. I mean, he's just been there for a few months, and he's never been a soldier. And he was thinking, since I have nowhere else to go, I might as well go to Moscow, never been there before. And get to meet Stalin and get my red star. So sure enough, the train made it to Moscow, and as they were getting to Moscow, he see a lot of commotion with them being surrounded by other soldiers. And soon he realized within a few days, he found a Jewish lady who was one of the secretaries for one of the generals. And she told him that the reason they told him about coming to Moscow was a complete fabrication, because this whole unit is going to now go to Manchuria to fight the Japanese in China, in Manchuria. And before he knew it, the train started moving again, going towards Manchuria, towards China, because the war was still raging before Hiroshima and Nagasaki in the east. So, you know, he describes in the book, and again, I'm not going to read it, but he describes in the book how he just couldn't do that. He said, I just cannot go to face another war in the Far East. I have to find a way out of this train. He just didn't have the physical, emotional, mental stability to go with the Red Army to Manchuria to fight the Japanese. And so, through his connection with this lady, who was Jewish, she felt very sorry for him. She talked to the general, or one of the generals, I'm not sure if he was the top commander, I can't remember, but she gave him a few rubles and a two or three day trip east of Moscow. In the middle of the night, he describes they are stopping in this train station. It wasn't a town, it was just like a switching station where the trains switch directions. And he was dropped off the train. And he was just left there. The train continued to go. It's the middle of the night and it's dark. He's there, maybe 17, he's 17, maybe 17 and a half years old. And there it is, in the middle of the world, by himself, with no one left, with just a few rubles. So, that was for him, really, the lowest point. And from there, he really kept building his life. And he hopped on a freight train, a logging train, that went back to Moscow, and was on top of the logs. And for two or three days, and miraculously, he heard some voices, and there were two ladies, two Russian ladies, not Jewish, that were there. It's a long story because they were looking for the husbands. That was from St. Petersburg, Stalingrad, as it was called, right, Professor?
Leningrad.
Sorry, thank you. And he made it back to Moscow, and then. Through other events, made it back to Vilna, and hoping to find something to do. And of course, everything was destroyed. He couldn't get his apartment back. Other people already squatted in the apartment. And so he made connection to Zionist groups in refugee camps, and ended up later on in outside of Frankfurt. And he's now maybe, fast forwarding, he's maybe 19 or 20 years old, and he's now the administrator, which is this is really remarkable to believe. He is an administrator of a refugee camp with 22,000 refugees. And it's just remarkable, the leadership and the result. And actually, my favorite picture is right here in the book, where he's dressed very like a really good-looking suit, and he's 20 years old, and he's walking inside that camp, and later on found his way back to Israel and started life all over. So I just want to show this a couple of tidbits from the story of basically descending to hell and rebuilding back very, very slowly. And his book is, by the way, available on Amazon, so you're welcome to look for it. So, a couple of things I'd like to do now is first ask you if you have any questions, but also I'd like to invite my sister and daughter and niece up front, because what I thought we'll do is tell you personally what it was like to grow up in a household had the shadow of the Holocaust. And I can start, and if you'd like to join me just for a few minutes, Chaya. And they didn't know I was going to do that, so they're a bit surprised, but. Second or third generation, depends how you look at it, can share some words. Of course, my daughter was born and raised in the United States, so she has her own perspective, and then Yael is in Israel. So, for me, we're still learning details about the Holocaust. We don't know the whole story because the emotional baggage for our parents, and I said our parents because respectfully, our mother had it actually much worse than our dad. She's a Holocaust survivor from Poland. She survived Auschwitz and also was orphaned when she was 12 years old. She has lost seven brothers and sisters and her parents and extended family in Holocaust. So that's for another day, perhaps. But the bottom line is that we grew up in a house we didn't know what a grandparent was. And so even now with the Stolpers thing, I don't refer to the people that we memorialized as my grandparents. Because I don't really have a feel what does it mean to have a grandparent. For me, these are my father's parents and his sister. She's not my aunt, she's his sister, because I don't know what it means to have an aunt. And so, it was growing up in a house was there's very, very little discussion about the Holocaust. We just had the year of the candle, the Yahrzeit candle, during the anniversary of their parents. And I think the grandmother also, if I remember right. But there was always this unmovable, unforgiving cloud for me. I don't know, we'll see what my sister remembers and feels, but for me there was a permanent, invisible shadow behind you, which is the Holocaust. And it was unshakable. And a lot of my friends that I grew up with in Ramat Gan came from a different background. I don't know that I knew anyone that lost as many family members as we did. I'm sure there were plenty, but I just don't recall. But there was this constant shadow. And, I was lucky to have a very, very happy childhood, nevertheless, and going to the Israeli Air Force for 4 years when I was 18. And for me, it was a very liberating experience because I left the house, to be honest, and just to be on my own and to live my own life and to feel a little free to be with people that didn't have that shadow of the Holocaust. It was very liberating for me. And it was just a lot healthier. And So after that, I went to college in the United States, but started building my life really, really far away. And I met a friend in Boulder, Colorado, where I lived for 11 years. That's where my brother was born. Actually, it was a very, very bright Jewish person from Iran, from Persia. And we were in a dinner party one day, and someone asked me, "So, you from Israel? Oh, great. How did you make it to Colorado?" And I stumbled. I mean, I didn't have a quick or witty answer. And so I paused for a second. So Simanto was his name, picked up a globe that was at the end of the table. And he said to the folks in the dinner table, he turned around, "So you see this Tel Aviv?" Then turned around to exactly the other side. Here's Boulder, Colorado. That's why he's here, because it's the other side of Tel Aviv. He wants to run away from the Holocaust. And he was very, very right.
But you left me, which is very nice. Exactly.
So, I will pause now and let my sister Chaya.
Any questions?
Any questions first? Okay.
Okay, if that's okay, I'm
going to
ask you one question specifically about the Holocaust.
Sure.
Could you describe a little bit more? what, you know, how the town will look like before the war. I'm sure, I don't know how much information we have about that. You know, how many people there were in your household, how did you live, how did your grandparents live, and what happened during the Holocaust?
I'll start? Okay. There was a small family at the start of the war, which is the year of my father's bar mitzvah, 1939. He lived with his younger sister Lily, who was...
Shivan sounds the same as Shivan.
It is, it is.
Does it still exist?
It's yes,
still...
it exists. Okay. I've been there many times.
Okay.
It's about 50 kilometers from this.
Okay. And his parents moved to Vilna, so my dad was born in Vilna. And so they did not live in the Jewish quarter, they lived actually outside in the building where we laid the Stolpersteen, very close by. If you continue down in Gediminas and then take a right couple blocks, it's very close to here. And so, but they were forced into the ghetto, and there was quite a shock because they had a very, I guess they were fairly affluent, and they were had a very, very nice living space.
Can I just tell
you? Yeah, of course, please.
I wanted to talk about the education my father talked about a lot. He studied in Tarbut school, and his Hebrew was so excellent. It was amazing that Israeli people couldn't reach the level he talked. And wrote. And he used to speak a lot about Tarbut as a place where he not only got knowledge but also education and love to Judaism and to Israel.
Okay. Are there questions, Ruti, or comment from anyone?
I'm gonna keep asking until somebody becomes a little bit braver and
I'm curious, couple things, and I'll offer a few questions that you can choose to bring them an answer. One is how your parents they speak to each other in Yiddish when you were growing up and how they met. And also when you say that there was a constant shadow or dark cloud with you, can you say more about what that actually meant? Did your parents talk about your experience, or was it?
I'll start with the easy one, and then it'll be interesting to get Chaya's perspective. So they spoke Yiddish between them, and when they didn't want me to understand, they switched to Polish. Because, and then my sister figured out Polish, because she's a couple of months older than I am. And so there were no secrets anymore, because she understood a little bit of the Polish. But yeah, they spoke Yiddish. Funny thing about the Yiddish is that, I don't know how many of you know, but my mother's from Lodz, Poland, and the accent, the dialect between Lodz and Vilna is very, very different.
The Yiddish.
The Yiddish. And we used to, among the Jews in Israel, to make fun, to talk down to the Polish Yiddish. The Vilna Yiddish was like talking, like in England, pardon?
Posh.
It was very posh. It was so
high. It's considered to be.
Over the years, our mother gave up a lot, her whole identity for our father, as my sister reminded us last night over dinner. She even changed her Yiddish, and she sounded like a Vilner in later years.
And
the cooking, right? That's right, exactly. Another question I forgot, but I don't think it's much fun, so I'm sorry.
How did they met, and then?
You know that better than I do.
Well, yes. My mother, she was 19 when she came, when she converted to Israel after Holocaust. And at first she was in the kibbutz, anybody knows what the kibbutz is? Yes. And after a while, she went to, she moved to her sister, who got married, and she lived with them in a town named Ramat HaSharon, in not far from Tel Aviv, and she worked actually in the fields, strawberry fields,
picking strawberries.
And at that time, my father was a soldier in the Israeli army, starting it was the Haganah first, and they just went to dance together. They met in a dancing party.
Well,
yes.
We sat down with my grandmother. My grandmother always likes to say that she actually had a boyfriend when they met. Yes. But she said, your grandfather, he wasn't as good looking as my boyfriend, but he was much more charming, and the way he spoke just caught my heart. I think that's just lovely.
This is how they met, and they really started from nothing. Two orphans with no family, almost nothing at all. And they started to build a new living. My mother didn't work all these years. She raising us was her mission in life. She took part in activities in all kind of activities, but as a charity activities, yes. And my father did very well in his job as an accountant, and he was doing well. It wasn't easy being a child. My mother didn't talk at all during all these years. I knew that something horrible, horrible, horrible happened. And bear in mind that I wasn't the only child who had this experience. Lots of my friends' parents were in the same situation. But this was until, when did she start speaking? It was an occasion where there was a gathering of women, Witzel women, if you know, Witzel.
It's a women's organization, yeah.
Yeah. And her friends there asked her, Paula, why don't you tell us your story? We always hear this one story, the other one story. What about your own story? So one year she said, you know what? If my granddaughter is going to come and to hold my hand, I'm going to do that. So Yael's sister, my other daughter, Dana, she came with her. She really held her hand.
Literally.
And my mother, for the first time, told her story, which was really, really hard to observe. And
3 hours.
Yeah. Later on, it was she was interviewed by the Steven Spielberg
Shoah,
yes, interviews.
How old was she at that time?
At that time, it was 20 years ago. She was in her 60s, yes. Now she's in her 80s. About 20 years ago, yes. So this was for the first time. And then she started telling more and more. And they're asking her. Because before that, not talking about it. On the other hand, my father was a big talker, I have to say.
Yeah.
He had this will to talk all the time, right? He spoke a lot. And after a while, he got involved very intensively with the Vilna's whole house, you know, the organization, the association. So Vilna actually was in the center of our life since I remember myself. Vilna, all the time.
He was the chairperson of the left for Israel from Vilna, yes.
Yes, yes, this association, yes.
Well, as part of his job, he did the memorial service every Yom HaShoah, which is the Israeli day of memorial for the Holocaust. And every year he stands there and he speaks in front of everybody, tells his story, and he's an amazing public speaker, my grandfather.
And I remember a few years ago, not long, two, 3 years ago, after he got the Boy Scouts, Boy and Girl Scouts of Israel, to take part as well, and the Israeli Navy. Anyway, he told his story and it was amazing and everybody cried and he got up and somebody, one of the kids for the Boy Scout came up to my grandmother and they said, are you a survivor as well? Can you tell us your story? And that was the first time I saw her standing tall, telling her stories to children. There was something about telling it to young people, to teenagers, children. They gave her strength. Do you remember that day? It was, she just stood there and she said, you know what, looking at you, I'm so proud to see how you're here and in Israel and carrying on and surviving. And it was just, and I thought that was a great notion.
Of course, seeing the young people in Israel is also a very, very important experience for us. I was a school principal for 4 years in Israel, and wherever I gathered all the schools together, you know, hundreds and hundreds of pupils together, and I looked at them and said, oh, that here we are, here we are. We are here. We are big, we are strong, we are not only surviving, we are prosperous, you know, so this is really, really great.
It's interesting that you just mentioned Donor a lot, and you said that Donor was, in a sense, at the center of your life. And that's going to be a question for Ephraim as well. We all know that, you know, Donor was used to call the Jerusalem of North. And I was wondering how much of that do you sense when you come to Roma, to Vilnius, and how the place does look for you all, you know, like from your perspective.
Well, I mean,
well, that really not the person to start, because my answer is really that I never felt any connection with Vilna, because my grandmother's sister, Fadi Levando, or someone I never knew, and no one talked about her. And what was described just now, psychologists have identified as a very typical phenomenon of survivors who cannot tell their story to their children, but do feel the need to tell it to their grandchildren. So there's a kind of transmission, transgenerational transmission to the third generation at some point. They realize they have to tell the story to someone who will carry on. They cannot tell it to the children, it's too painful. And sometimes they're afraid to hurt their children. They want to protect them from this traumatic experience that they've had. My experience was not like that. My father, who escaped from Germany on the Kinder transport, would never talk about his family. He lost everyone. But he never had experience of actually being in Harkov, or he just said goodbye to them and never saw them again. So in my family, my father never talked, although he talked to other people, and my grandmother never talked about her sister, and never mentioned her to me either. But then I think there was something else going on, and that is that that particular generation of our grandparents lived in a world where people didn't talk about things that were painful. If someone was terminally ill or something terrible happened, they didn't tell the children. That wasn't part of the culture. It's only nowadays, we forget that nowadays everything's out in the open, parents have to tell everything to the children, involve them in all their feelings and so on. The world before the Second World War wasn't like that. People didn't usually open up. So I think that the reason I didn't hear anything about my aunt from my grandmother is simply that she's had so many losses in her life. She lost two of her children, her husband, after the Second World War. It was so difficult, especially after the Second World War, even if you weren't a survivor, to make a living, to try and keep the family going. There wasn't time for telling stories. And that generation who were born when Tsar was still ruling here, didn't even know exactly when they were born, they didn't have papers, They didn't keep records of their relatives, and that's important for us to try and reconstruct who our relatives were, who died in which concentration camp, and to try and do that. And I've been through that with my father, and we had a Sobel Steiner installation last year in Germany from my father's family and from my father also. So I've been through that on my father's side. On the side of my mother, it was just Fanny Lavando who was lost in the Holocaust. She was just lost. Absent, without the present. My mother kept copies of the Torquay book and tried to have some of the letters translated just for her own sake. But no one ever thought of publishing it or doing something with this empty memory. So for me, unfortunately, this is my first visit to Vilna. I know a lot about Vilna from history books that I've read, from our general cultural knowledge of what Vilna means to us in Israel, in terms of literature and history and the partisans and the Holocaust, but not for my family. So I'm very sorry, I'm not getting a very helpful answer.
Well, I can only say welcome.
I just want to address this also. What it is to me is when I'm here, when I'm away from here, Vilna has the memory of growing up and the city of the hill, so to speak. But when I'm here, to be honest, totally, brutally honest, it comes to one thing, anti-Semitism, or trying to understand anti-Semitism. I walk the street and it reeks to me of anti-Semitism. Not because anyone treats me badly, but I just can't escape thinking, how could this have happened? Every street, every building had Jews in there. And so I just can't shake that off really while I'm here. It's trying to understand the why. What are the causes? And there are many books, there are probably libraries that are written on the subject of anti-Semitism, and it's going to take us many, many, many days to discuss. So I don't want to open that kind of worm, but I'm just answering honestly. That to me, that is really what's behind it. What I'm here right now, trying to understand why, how could this have happened? How do you explain that people can do that to other people? And I want the answer to it.
If that's okay, I'm going to ask you a very personal question, which is sort of connected with what you just said right now. My grandfather, from my mother's side, he helped Jews. But the other grandfather probably was somebody who participated in the mass executions. We don't really know, but it's highly possible from the position that he held at that time. So, also, you know, what does it mean? What does it feel to sit to you in front of somebody who might be an executioner and at the same time somebody who helped? It sort of, you know, represents the level of the Lithuanians today, right?
Well, it's such an easy answer. I'm going to let my sister answer it first.
I don't know that I can answer that question directly with Lithuania, but kind of on a different note, we were talking about this the other day with Germany. So how can you even, I can't stand to even hear that language. My grandparents, Sabin Safta actually lived there for several years. That's in the book. He had a very big position where he would go to Frankfurt. And so the question is, how can you even stand and go back to a country? So I know it's not directly answering your question, but I think I have a lot to learn because my grandparents who went through that actually lived in that country. And I can't even stand to hear the language, quite frankly. So I think I have a lot to learn, a lot to grow. I wasn't like Gael, I didn't grow up in Israel. I grew up in the United States, so I was a little sheltered from the Holocaust, but I think, you know, and I've been to Germany as a lot younger, so I think I have a lot to learn, but it's very hard for me to hear the German language and see the Germans and even go. Our flight was through Frankfurt, and I don't know how she could have gone back.
I've asked that because I've asked my grandparents that because when they lived there when I was younger, We went to visit them, and people said to me, how dare you go there? How dare you go to the country who murdered our people? And I asked my grandmother and my grandparents, and I went up to them and I said, how can you live there? How can you? And they said to me something I'll never ever forget. They said, for us to live there as successful people, as a representative of Israel, as a representative of the surviving generation, is the biggest victory I can possibly think of. Because we're sitting there and we're talking to people who know, who personally know people who have participated in the murders, who participated in this. And we're there, we're saying, you didn't do this. Not only have we survived, we procreated, we have children, we have grandchildren, we have a country, we have... And we're here, and you know, you tried to make us go away, and you couldn't, so...
Yeah. I talked yesterday about the bipolarity of the human race, of human nature, between horror, cruelty, and kindness. And really, I mean, I didn't know until now, but your great-grandparents, but that really depicts exactly what I was trying to say, how we are capable as humans to be so kind and so cruel. And the reason why is beyond me.
I think there is no other chance but to give hope and communication and you know, talking to each other and resolving things and issues. This is the only way. To when you hate and the hatred grows and grows, what good does it make? I mean, it's awful. It's terrible for the one who lives this life, and it's terrible for everybody. The only way and the only hope is to try to talk and to understand each other. This is the only way I believe in. The only way.
Are there any questions from the audience? Okay, so maybe I'll try to wrap up this discussion. Ask you sort of a question that would be, in a sense, conclusive. If all of you were Lithuanians today, you know, with the burden of the history and the legacy that we have in this country regarding the Holocaust, what would you do?
Nothing. Yeah? If we were Lithuanians? Yeah, no, Jewish Lithuanians.
Today.
Well, I think that's a question that's difficult to answer because we're not Lithuanians. You can't answer a hypothetical question because we are from Israel or from the United States. We live in a very different culture. And although I know how complex Holocaust memory is in Lithuania, I can't imagine being in that situation because I don't know enough about Lithuanian culture and Lithuanian history. I know about the Soviet repression of the Holocaust, and I know enough about the ambivalence towards Holocaust in many countries. But I think Lithuania is perhaps going through something similar that happened in France. Way back in the 1970s, I thought of this yesterday when we were watching the film Out of the Forest, because in France, de Gaulle marched into Paris this very triumphant, in this very triumphant way up the Champs-Élysées and celebrated the victory of the French over the Germans. And everyone pretended that they'd all been in resistance, when everyone knew it wasn't true, that most French people had collaborated. The French police had rounded up Jews. My father's parents and his aunt, grandmother's sister, were sent by the French from French camps to Auschwitz. And I mean now, some conversation has been discussed for survivors only today, all those years after, they are no longer alive and cannot receive that compensation. And in the 1970s, there was a French film director called Marcel Auguste, who produced a very famous film called Le Chagrin de la Pitié, translate the chagrin, the sadness, whatever, and the pity. And it's a film like the one we saw last night, which spoke to the French about collaboration by interviewing French people who had been there and talking about what they did. And it was no longer possible to lie that the French were all war heroes. So there was that very gradual and very, very difficult change within society, not just about Jews, but about collaboration in general. And I think the time has come for Lithuania to go through that. I don't think Lithuania is the same as France. Lithuania has its own political situation, its own cultural situation. So it's a very difficult question to answer. I think what you have achieved this week is the first step. And I was at Malata on the march. I heard the speeches, and also on Tuesday we had the speech of the Lord Mayor of Vilna. And I hear very, very clearly that something is beginning to change, but it's a beginning. And that's something that you Lithuanians have to discuss openly among yourselves. And I definitely, I personally could possibly answer that question, but what I would do. It's a very complex situation. I don't add, this is the last word on the subject, but I think also what we have to remember that it's not just black and white. It's not just, did they hate the Jews? They're all anti-Semites and we should not have anything to do with them. And some people who would not go to Germany, some people today would assume that Lithuanians are anti-Semitic because of what happened in the Holocaust. But I think we forget that there's one thing even worse than hatred, and that's indifference. By doing nothing, you can murder a lot of people. And as we saw in the film last night, Out of the Forest, I think this is true of not just the Lithuanian, but other places. In Germany, for example, people just stood by and they did nothing. And when we had to stop the Steiner installation, my father's family in Germany, someone, a very good, decent man, who had forced the local municipality, more or less forced them, to have this stop sign, the first ones in that town, found a photograph in an in the archive, local archives, of my grandfather, my grandmother, and my aunt, Rosa, being led to the railway station, being deported, October 22nd, 1940, and the good citizens of Brookville, just standing there watching. Complete apathy and indifference on their faces. A few Gestapo, the police, maintaining order, not one person raised an eyebrow. Complete apathy and indifference. I think that's much more lethal than notice.
Well, I think the point about indifference is excellent, and I just want to say that if any advice or to the Lithuanian is that small acts are very big, just like the Stolpersteine. It's a small 10 by 10 centimeters, but it's just a huge step forward, and these things are going to be grass-rooted as opposed to top-down, it will be bottom-up, and which is very evident from what you, your organization has done. It's going to come up from the bottom, and then the country will have no choice, and the leadership will have to join forces with you. So I commend you for what you've done, as we all did yesterday. It's going to come from the people.
Yes, please. One other small comment that I think Lithuania is obviously not the only one. I mean, when we were talking to Gunter yesterday, I said, how many Silverstein do you have in Poland? Because I just assumed, you know, with our grandmother being, I just assumed it would be thousands. He said six. So I think a lot of countries have the same work to do. And I also think it's rooted to thousands and thousands and thousands of years that the Jews have been hated by people all over the world. So I think it's something that all over the world people need to be thinking about, which is why I'm just so happy to be here and to bring these stories back to the States and back to my friends who are, all of my friends are Christian and they don't know anything about all of this. So I think it's just, it's education, like Haya was saying.
I think that things should start from knowledge, talking about them and knowledge all the time, to know the facts. And after you know the facts, you can start dealing with it, even though it is so hard. But if the facts are hidden, it's a big problem. You cannot really make progress and a real change. So I think it should start with talking about things and letting everybody know and processing it from here.
Are there any questions from the audience? Comments? No. Okay.
No.
So this is a typical reaction of Lithuanian. Don't think that they're not interested. That's a cultural thing. People.
It's the other way around.
I mean, I would sit here and, you know, would ask no questions as well.
It's all right. Thank you for listening.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for your time and thank you for coming to Lithuania. We really appreciate that.
Thank you for your
What about in the front? Yeah. Oh, you want to do it where you wrote? Yes.
My name was that. Really good.
I'm not too sure that my friend is. So this is.